You can start now, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you. I am Ravichandran from National Center for Polar and Ocean Research, Goa, Ministry of Earth Sciences. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. M. Rajivan, Secretary, Ministry of Earth Sciences, for initiating this webinar series to showcase MoE's activities and also to share some of the fundamental aspects of various earth system components to all. I think this is a part of Ministry of Earth Sciences reach out program, also DESC, that is the manpower development of earth system science in terms of capacity building initiative. This webinar series is started. So far, many institutions, many scientists from MoES covering both ocean, atmosphere, geoscience, and polar science are covered. And today I will be talking about Indian Argo project, Indian Arctic program. I also thank Dr. Kopal and also Dr. Vinu and his team for facilitating this webinar series. So I will switch on to my presentation so that everybody can view. Are you able to see the presentation?
Not yet.
Not yet?
Yes, we can. Please hide the bar. Yes, please continue.
Okay. So I'll be talking about the Indian Argo project. If you have any clarification or any doubt or anything, you can always mail to me in my email address, which is mentioned here. So this is my outline of the talk, basically some background about the Arctic, and I will go with the present status of Arctic sea ice, and if it is sea ice is decreasing, what is its impact in terms of Arctic ice melt, both in terms of benefits as well as risk. Then I will move on to evidence of Arctic change in terms of different elements, and I will mainly focus on Arctic amplification, Arctic oscillation, and also monsoon teleconnection. And lastly, I will briefly summarize about India's effort in Arctic research. Essentially, I will cover first one third of the things about background and impacts of Arctic sea melt, and another one third I will talk about elements of Arctic change, and the third one is I will talk about India's effort in Arctic research in third part. If time permits, I will show some small video about 5 to 6 minutes about glimpses of Arctic observations. There are three poles in the globe. It is a different view from the globe picture, and Arctic, Antarctic, and Himalaya are all three are the components of the cryospheric component of the earth system. Under the global warming scenario, the first and foremost place to warm up is, or warming can be noticed in this three regions. The climate is first and foremost also felt at this place. Antarctica is basically land covered by ocean, and it is already discussed my colleague Dr. Rahul Mogan about Antarctic program, and the Himalaya is called the third pole, and it is a mountain glaciers, and it is already covered by my colleague Dr. Thamban Maloth. And Arctic is ocean essentially and covered by the land mass, and today I will talk about this. So considering all the three cryospheric component, so these regions also holds lot of fresh water fresh waters because of the snow and ice is present here. And the studying this polar region is key because of the importance of cryospheric component. You see that as our body temperature is warms up, and for any particular reason, any problem, then later on, further it is warming up, we get almost what is called tears in the ice or get watery ice. So similar way, if the global earth is warms up, warming, then the first place to cry is the cryospheric component of the earth system, that is Antarctica, Himalaya, and Arctic. Hence, it is important to study these regions, not only the present, but also the past, to understand the present as well as to predict the future. Coming back to how do you define the Arctic? Actually, there are different definitions are there in the Arctic. The first most prominent one is the Arctic Circle. The Arctic Circle is basically about 66 degree and a half a degree northern limit. So within that limit, whatever the region, it is covered Arctic Circle. Basically, in this region, most of at least one day, a full day daytime during summer and full day nighttime during winter exists. And the another way of definition is about 10 degree isotherm in July, wherever the 10 degree atmospheric temperature exists, and that region, it is called Arctic region. And the third one is, third way of defining is the tree line. Basically, the northernmost limit of the trees exist in the Arctic regions. So basically, the ecology people, they consider as a tree line is the Arctic region rather than Arctic Circle. So anyway, it is all three way of defining this Arctic is there. And it is having a lot of uniqueness in the Arctic. Basically, as I mentioned, ocean is surrounded by land, this Arctic region, and it has a sea ice component, and also there are ice sheet, especially in the Greenland, and the ice sheet is in the Greenland. If all the ice sheet melts, it is almost equivalent to 7 meters sea level rise in the global ocean. So that much ice sheet exists in Greenland, and of course equally important in Antarctic also. And also the permafrost exists in the Arctic region, and it has a lot of greenhouse gases. So once this permafrost is thawing or melting, then this greenhouse gases will release, then both carbon dioxide and methane will pump into the atmosphere. Then again, the warming effect will take place. Also, Arctic has a rich biodiversity, and it is having both flora and fauna in terms of polar bear, walrus, and many other birds. And the uniqueness of this region is indigenous group is staying all over the coastal region of Arctic. So essentially, this is a place where the region of rapid change under the global warming scenario. So the impact of this is not only local, but also global. So how do we, how this Arctic is governed? Actually, unlike in Antarctica, where there is an Antarctic Treaty and it is a global common, but whereas in Arctic, the Arctic Council is the nodal agency and it is a leading intergovernmental forum for promoting Arctic cooperation. And though it does not create legally binding obligation for members, but presently there are 8 countries, Canada, Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Norway, Russia, Sweden, and US are the members of the Arctic Council. Also, there are 6 permanent participants. Mainly, they are from indigenous community, are involved in this Arctic governance. And there are about 13 observers countries also in the Arctic Council. And 25 governmental and non-governmental organizations are also observers in the Arctic Council. The aim of this Arctic Council, actually, to take care of this Arctic region, this Arctic Council has formed 6 working groups, mainly to monitor and collect the data and information and also assess the what is the changing Arctic region, and also make a policy and to define the best practices and also international cooperations. So these working groups meet frequently and they go for what is to be done and other things they plan. This Arctic Council has a chairman, and this chairman is rotated once in 2 years, and presently Iceland is the chairman for the Arctic Council. And every 2 years the priority areas are changed, and the currently the priority areas is pollution and sustainable fishing, with the special emphasis on microplastic. There are another important body. It is mainly relevant to science. It is a International Arctic Science Committee. So they mainly deal with the Arctic science related issues, both the physics, chemistry, biology, and all aspects of science. They look into this one. Currently, actually, India has an observer status in the Arctic Council since 2013, after we started some observations in the Arctic. The natives of the Arctic, basically the indigenous community, they are the central role in decision making Arctic affairs, because all along the coastline they are there, and the people called in different names and different region, Inuit, Sami, or Chukchi, like that. But their life is actually changing very rapidly, so they are trying to adapt the new way of life in the coastal regions. So of course the most major part of decision making, they are the part of Arctic Council. Also, Arctic has a lot of flora as well as fauna in the Arctic. During summer time, only during short blooming season and autumn season, there are a lot of flowers pop up, and you can visibly see that flowering things in the Arctic. But of course in Antarctic you cannot see such a flower even in summer. And fauna in the Arctic, of course the uniqueness of the fauna is basically polar bear and walrus. It is very unique in these regions, and also very unique birds are there in the Arctic. This particular bird, basically Arctic tern, it is very interesting bird. It migrates actually it is in the summer it comes to the Arctic, and after in the winter in the northern hemisphere it all the way goes to the Antarctic, and again next summer it comes to Arctic. So this bird, it is only every year it goes both summer, northern summer as well as southern summer, and it is almost migrating about 90,000 kilometer in a year, and this is the only longest migration bird in the world. That unique bird is Arctic tern. So coming back to Arctic climate system, basically the Arctic region, basically it is surrounded by the ocean. It is basically a heat sink of the earth, and the basically it is the Atlantic warm water is enter into the Arctic regions, and the cold Arctic waters is going away from the Arctic in this region, and also there is a cold deep water goes into this Atlantic. So that is what mainly contribute to the thermocline circulations. Also, there are a lot of river runoff as well as glacier melt all around the Arctic regions that contribute to the fresh water into the Arctic regions. So basically Arctic is warming, and also ice and snows are melting, and there are increasing runoff in the glaciers as well as the rivers, and the Greenland ice sheet also is melting, and the deep water formation as well as conveyor belt is modulated by because of this region. So Arctic region is not only the local effect, and its effect is seen elsewhere else. So coming back to some basics, basically why we are worried about Arctic. Basically the sunlight reflectivity on ice and ocean is unique in this area. Whenever ice and sea snow covers are there, whatever the sunlight has come to the surface, so about 85% to 90% it is reflected back to the surface. So the below the ocean, doesn't get heat energy. Whereas if it is ocean, most of the sunlight, whatever the sunlight it comes, up to 94% of the energy, it is absorbed by the ocean. Only small fraction of the sunlight is energy is reflected back to the atmosphere. So whenever there is a sea ice is reduction, then more water is opened up, then the large amount of heat is absorbed by the ocean. So that's why this warming effect is happening. So if it is in the open ocean, so this most of the energy, about 94%, is absorbed by the ocean. But if it is only bare ice, it is without any snow, then 50% of the energy is transmitted below the ice, because it is a transparent, it's a multi-year ice or new ice. It is only passed on to the subsurface. But if it is covered with the snow, then most of the energy is reflected back. So that's why when we are talking about the Arctic Ocean, if it is more open water, then the heating effect is felt much more. Another interesting, mostly misnomer, or sometimes people confuse with the sea ice and land ice. The sea ice is basically the ice in the ocean, and it is its buoyancy it is already taken into account. When the sea ice melts, then there is no sea level rise will take place. But whereas the land ice, it is, for example, in the Greenland ice sheet and other thing, if that land ice melt, then the sea level will increase. And also if it is cold, the entire glacier melt and falls into the ocean, then that time also the sea level is increasing. So the essentially these sea ice is largely contributed to the radiation budget, whereas the land ice largely contribute to the sea level rise. About 10% of this present sea level rise is present sea level rise of the global ocean is from the Greenland ice sheet presently, about 0.3 mm per year. So this is basically sea ice extent over the 1500 years. It is basically reconstructed from the sediment core. You can see that there are natural variability up to 1990 or so, and afterwards there is a unprecedented drop in the sea ice extent, and after 1990s. So that I don't think this will be, it is called a tipping point, so I don't think it will reverse back. So it is basically considered to be because of the anthropogenic effect. So even 1500 years, it is almost, there is a, these are the natural variability, but this is mostly in the recent observations where you have a large change in the sea ice extent. In the recent time, what is the present status of sea ice extent? So the left side of the figure shows the seasonal cycle of sea ice extent. Of course, it is a million square kilometers, and the dark color, actually it is basically black curve, shows the monthly variation or mean monthly variation of the sea ice extent. You can see this is in summer, and whereas this particular place is in winter. So the red one is 1979, so it is more sea ice extent, whereas the 2019, the green one, it is almost reduced sea ice extent. So this is a reduction in year to year. Whereas the reduction in year to year in summer is more pronounced than in the winter. So actually this is very clearly seen that the summer sea ice, it is almost reducing by half from the 1979 base value. If you see the long-term trend in the summer, and maybe from 1979 to present, it is a satellite era, you can see that very clearly there is a decreasing trend in summer sea ice. I think this is a recent publication from NCPOR colleague Chugi, and our colleagues from Avinash and Rahul, they have published recently. So there is a very clear evidence that there is a change in sea ice reduction. The sea ice extent is not only reducing in spatially, but also is ice thickness, in terms of thickness also it is decreasing, and also because of thickness as well as area it is decreasing, the volume also is shrinking. This is a typical area of CIS X10 in 1979. It is almost about 7.1 million square kilometer in the year 1979, but it has reduced to 3.6 million square kilometer in 2012. That is the lowest to summer sea ice is observed in the Arctic. And of course in 2019 it has gone to 4.3 million square kilometer. So these are the different year to year variability of sea ice extent as well as ice thickness and volume. It is shrinking. Now we know that yes, there is a sea ice decrease is happening, Arctic sea ice is decreasing. So what is the impact or what is the consequence of this warming as well as melting? So there are four important things or four important changes happening in the Arctic. Number one is the climate change. So because of change in sea ice, there are all hydrosphere, atmosphere, cryosphere, geosphere, all the things are changing. And maybe I will cover a little bit about what are the changes exactly happening in the climate change in the Arctic. I will cover later. So this is number one, climate change is the major impact. And other thing is the resources. In the resources, there are two things. One is living resources, one is fisheries, and other one is non-living resources. Basically oil and gas and some of the metals are available in the Arctic regions. And the third one is basically northern optimum ship route. So these are the major things, components or consequences, changes expected. So when we come to fisheries, the tropical region, when the ocean is get warms, the tropical species try to go for the colder regions. Either it has to dive deep or it has to migrate to the temperate region, that is mid-latitude regions. The mid-latitude region fisheries are trying to migrate to polar regions or dive deep. So if Arctic ice melts or if the ocean is warming, the more fisheries will be available in the Arctic regions, whereas in the tropical region, the fish productivity will be reduced, either migrate or it will go in extinction or it will go deep dive this one. So the fisheries is the major consequences of the Arctic ice melt. The other important thing is about 90 billion barrels of oil reserves are exist in the Arctic regions. Some of the things are maybe these are the areas where the potential of oil reserves. Some of the things are oil, somewhere it is gas form, and something liquid, some places in the liquid gas forms are available. So once this Arctic ice melts, so it is a possibility to harness this energy to the common kind. So that is why everybody is interested to know what is happening in the oil, what is happening in the Arctic and its consequences to exploit the resources. Another important thing is when the sea ice reduction is happening in the Arctic, then the ship route also changes drastically. So maybe I will cover 2-3 slides about ship routing in the later slides. So essentially what I want to convey here is when the Arctic is warming or it is melting, its consequences are four things. One is the climate change effect, not only local but also remote, and other one is living resources, and third one is non-living resources we can exploit, and the fourth one is changing ship routing, basically northern optimum ship route changes. So that these are the some of the consequences going to happen. Of course, there are loss of traditional way of life of indigenous community will change, and coastal erosions and other things will take place, and also there are environmental degradation will take place due to this Arctic warming. I will briefly summarize what are the economic impact, though I have mentioned earlier. So what are the economic impact of this Arctic ice decline? So number one is basically the non-living resources. So offshore exploration and extraction will benefit because of Arctic ice decline. About 13% of the oil 30% of the natural gas and 20% of natural gas in liquid forms. Of course, it is a global 13% of the oil from the global reserve. It is available in the Arctic. Of course, this can be harnessed because of the Arctic ice melt. But there are some consequences. There are some drawbacks. Because of Arctic sea ice melt, the wave conditions will go upward. That means wave condition will be strengthened. So we know that the northern sea already, it's a very rough sea. And now if sea ice is decreased, the wave will be much more strengthened. So it is a lot of problem. And also the infrastructure required for drilling and also to save, safely storage this fuel and other things, it is a problem. And another thing is, of course, I mentioned it is shipping. So the opening new routes will improve connection between the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. And also the ship route will drastically reduce the price of the shipping. And also the industry would be benefited. But problem is the marine ecosystem will degrade. More and more traffic, the oil spill will happen and the environment will be degraded. As of now, they have estimated a lot of minerals, especially nickel, copper, platinum, diamonds, gold, lead, zinc, all the metals are available in the Arctic regions. So it is possible to store, harness these minerals in the Arctic regions if the Arctic sea ice is opening up. Of course, thawing permafrost as well as erosion is likely to increase the challenges and increase the cost of the industry. Of course, as I mentioned, the marine fishery, as of now, about 10% of the global catch is from this Arctic region. If Arctic sea ice decline, and this region will definitely will increase the will increase the fish production on in this region. And also this migration and decline in stocks will consistently change the harvesting sites. And the last one is the tourism also will drastically will improve because the port and nowadays the longer seasons expected. So the tourism will enhanced. When the tourism is enhanced, then the problem is with the wildlife and also the landscape and the ecosystem disruption will be taking place. So it is not only due to economic impact because of the Arctic ice decline, but also there are social and political impacts as well. So social in terms of the deeply affecting circumpolar societies will be altered, the altering of structure of the local communities, and also it will hamper the traditional means of transportation, and also their diet and identity of local communities also will change. As I seen that last time when I went to some of the Arctic place, now this indigenous community, instead of earlier they used to take fish and other animals, but now they are taking some indigenous community. I have seen that they are taking pizza and other things. So they have like their lifestyle is changing. Of course, they have to adapt with the new way of life. In terms of political, actually the increased access of natural resources will also change the Arctic governance to readjust and cope with the new challenges. The change is also transboundary and no global power will be able to act alone to face it. Arctic states need to engage non-Arctic states and also non-Arctic actors. And also it is important to improve the relationship between the science and policy. So it is essentially need an international effort for cooperation, especially oil spill pollution prevention, shipping regulation and fisheries management. This is the present the polar navigation. So once this sea ice it is declined, and now then the Arctic sea route will be able to open up. So some of the sea routes already started. This is a north northern sea route via Russian coastal. And then there is a Northwest Passage along Canadian regions. So this region already, there are many vessels are started moving, especially in summer, but there are People are expecting there are another corridors also will open up. This is the Arctic Bridge route and maybe the Transpolar route. Of course, it is a long way to go for a Transpolar route. So the currently the two main routes, one is Northern Sea route as well as the Northwest Passage is opened up, and already ships are moving in this region. Just some simple calculations. Suppose if the ship route changes, suppose a container vessel is going from Yokohama in Japan to all the way to Hague in Norway, if it is if they want to ship from one this place to this place, the present route is they have to travel Pacific Ocean, then Malacca Strait, Indian Ocean, then it passed through the Suez Canal, Mediterranean, and then Atlantic. So all the way it has to go from this place to this place. So now if it is sea ice is open, they will be able to go this way, and that way it is about 30 to 38% saving is expected for each transport. Of course, these are the some of the advantages. So shorter distance means you can do more trips, fuel saving, and there are a lot of opportunities for regional actors. Ports and harbors it will be developed in this area, and also less carbon dioxide. And now, of course, the piracy issues can be avoided. Of course, there is no piracy much now, but this area is notorious for the piracy region. And these are some of the disadvantages. Of course, harsh shipping condition, and you required maybe the polar research vessel or ice class vessel, and sometime you have to face polar night and also extreme cold they have to face. And this area is not charted well, so maybe inadequate in nautical charts and lack of infrastructure along the route presently, because some problem happens to rescue and other things. It is a problem, and most of the time now it is passing because of the escort ship. Of course, the oil spill cleanup is a huge cost impact on that. So these are some of the advantages and some of the disadvantages. But essentially, if the Arctic ice melt, and this ship route will save about 30 to 38% only if you go for Northeast Asia to Southeast Asia to Europe countries if you want to. Of course, maybe India is not that much benefited, but there are these countries, many countries will be benefited in this ship route. So now I will come back to mainly on evidence, the Arctic ice melt, and what are the evidence is seen, and what is its impact in terms of climate change and weather and climate, basically. So the first one, you are able to see that increase in air temperature and dramatic reduction in summer ice, summertime sea ice extent, and the loss of multi-year sea ice reduction, basically the thickness as well as the volume is drastically decreasing, and also the ocean heat content is increasing and ocean acidification is amplified, and ecosystem also is changing in terms of fisheries and other things. And also the Greenland ice sheet is melting much faster, and also warming permafrost, so that this will impact the gas release from the permafrost. So these are the evidence of the Arctic warming, and its impact is largely on ecosystem and northern residents, and also changes in balance on physical process, not only physical process, all the physics, physical, chemical, and biological process, total ecosystem will change. And there are strong feedback mechanism will happen. And also it will not only impact the lower latitude, but also the tropics and, not only the local, but also in the tropics, the weather and climate will affect. So there are three major things which is very clearly seen is surface temperature warming, decreasing sea ice extent, and sea level rise. So these are the major component which is changing in the Arctic. Now I will just explain how the Arctic amplified during the recent time. The picture, this middle picture, it is shows the winter time surface air temperature trend, increasing trend from 1990 to 2013. You can see that very clearly the Arctic is warming much faster than any other place. So this phenomena is called Arctic complications. The left side figure is basically the trend of longitudinal average of the temperature trend, and you can see that almost double the temperature when compared to other latitude regions. Of course, there are some cooling effect in the mid-latitude regions. Coming back to the time series data in the bottom one, the black one is basically the temperature from 1960 to 2015, area averaged from 0 to 60 degree north, and the red one is in the northern latitude, basically 60 to 90 degree average. You can very clearly see that after 1990s, the increase in air temperature, very clearly visible. So now I will just see that, yes, we have observed that sea ice is declining and temperature is warming in the Arctic. Now I will just discuss what is the cause of this Arctic amplifications. Of course, there is no single reason or single cause for this amplification. There are many theories or observations or modeling studies are proposed. So I will just highlight some of the causes of Arctic amplification. So the one, number one is the temperature albedo feedback. When the Arctic temperature is increasing, then there is a possibility of more melting in the Arctic regions. When the melting is happening, then there is more open causes more clouds, and if it
is live streaming is on.
Please hold on a second. Please hold on. Computer team, can we go ahead?
Is it okay? Can I go ahead?
Please go ahead.
Okay. So the second mechanism for causing Arctic amplification is temperature cloud radiation. Basically, when the temperature increases, you have more open water, open ocean water, and when we have more open ocean water, it will have more evaporation, and there is a formation of clouds. And the more and more clouds form, then there is a outgoing long-wave radiation is trapped, so that the outgoing long-wave radiation, it is reflected back to the surface, then the surface is warming is increased, and eventually the temperature increases. But the caveat here is basically it is the clouds also reflect incoming solar radiation and may therefore give a cooling effect. So season is more important here. So for example, when during the winter time, when the cloud formation is happen, then it is a positive feedback. But during summer, a lot of incoming solar radiation itself, it is trapped by the cloud. So you will have not expected to have a positive feedback, and that time it may be negative feedback. And the third mechanism is ocean dynamics. Basically, in the left side figure, this one is a Atlantic Ocean, and this is a Arctic Ocean. The Atlantic Ocean, the temperature and salinity are throughout uniform in the upper ocean, and the it is basically warm and salty, and whereas in the Arctic region, it is more fresher and colder, more fresher as well as colder. But in between region, you will have the temperature is higher, but it is a fresher. At that region, you can expect the upward heat flux, basically the deep water from the Atlantic region. It is advected to the Arctic region, and it advected upwards. Then the heat is slowly, this heat is increased in this region, and the sea ice is eroded, and then open ocean is occurred. Once open ocean occurred, then the positive feedback continues. So essentially, this amplification is due to the enhanced heat flux across the yellow plane, especially this region. Another interesting study by Yeo et al. Is basically they were documenting our sensitivity experiment they have done, and basically the bottom left side figure is MJO is the Madden-Julian acceleration. Basically, it is a convective activity in the tropics. So this it has 8 phases, this MJO cycle, and the left side is a frequency of occurrence. Period 1, it is 1979 to 1993, and period 2 is 94 to 2008. In two period, he has computed what are the total number of MJO occurrence in all phases, and P2 also he has computed what are the occurrence of MJO, and he has clearly seen that, he has shown that the Indian Ocean region, especially 1 to 4, maybe 1 to 3, you have the frequency reduction is happening in the P2 region, sorry, the P2 period, the frequency of MJO is reduced, and whereas in the Pacific Ocean, the frequency has increased in the period 2. So this difference, if you compute what is the heat anomaly between these two, how much heat is transported from the tropics to poles, if you compute only due to MJO, this is the effect of this. So basically, this is a higher temperature difference between P2 minus P1. So this impact is mainly contributed from the MJO or the tropical convective activity. So he attributed that about 10 to 20% of the Arctic amplification is due to the tropical convective activity. So when the MJO heating in the tropic is followed by Arctic warming, whereas the MJO heating in the Indian Ocean is followed by the Arctic cooling. So now most of the time what is happening is the Pacific Ocean, the MJO frequencies are increasing when compared to Indian Ocean. So that's why the Arctic is amplified much more, like that he has documented. Another in synoptic time scale, another study, another many of people have documented. This is T.N. Krishnamurthy has documented. So the top left figure is he has computed some 8 heavy rainfall events happened in the ASEAN region, and this is basically a composite of 8 events. So whenever there is a heavy rainfall events occur in this region, then due to the rainfall, the latent heat release, it is all the way transported to the Arctic through Rossby wave mechanism, and especially the Canadian region where you get this heat is being transported this region, and thereby the temperature increases, then Arctic ice melt in that region. It takes about 6 to 8 days. It is in synoptic time scales. So this is a pathway of 8 heavy rainfall events, extreme rainfall events. During that time, you get the heat transported to Arctic. The bottom left figure is basically the increasing trend of rainfall over Northwest India as well as Northern Pakistan. You can see that the increasing trend of heavy rainfall events, extreme rainfall events happening. So whenever there is a extreme rainfall events is happening in the ASEAN region, you get the heat transported to the Arctic, Because of that heat, the Arctic ice is melting. That is what it is documented. Basically, the increasing mean temperature in the Asian continent causes decrease in Arctic ice volume during heavy rainfall events due to monsoon extreme events. So just I mentioned there are different mechanism exist in the Arctic amplification, why Arctic is amplified, or there are temperature albedo feedback, temperature cloud radiation feedback, and ocean dynamics due to vertical advection, and also the heat and moisture transport from tropics to all the way to Arctic. And there are some other mechanism also is there. It is basically the aerosol concentration changes, also deposit of black carbon and snow. So the various processes are happening. Due to this process, the Arctic is amplified. The another important aspect when you talk about Arctic is people talk about Arctic oscillations. The Arctic oscillation is basically changes in the pressure between the Arctic and the northern mid latitudes. When the pressure is high and the in the Arctic and low in mid latitudes, the Arctic oscillation in the negative phase. In the positive phase, this pattern is reversed. During the positive phase, there are a lot of storm events is occurring. Basically, the gradient in pressure pattern, the westerly winds are stronger, so you have a more storm events occur in this region. And the polar vortex, actually in the stratosphere, you have very strong polar winds. It is very strong winds happen in the stratosphere level. Whereas in the negative phase, you have the polar vortex is weakened. So because it is weakened, there are a lot of cold, what is called cold temperature, or it has been transported to the mid-latitude regions, and thereby you have a cold events occurring in US and other places. And during the negative phase, you can see that it is stratospheric winds, it is not only it is very straight, and actually it is a wobbling. So because of this wobbling nature, the vortex wobbling nature, you get the cold regime, bring it back to the mid latitude, and it affects the entire mid latitudes. Once the mid latitude affects, it is also affected by the tropics. So I will just briefly mention about what are the impact in the tropics, some studies. So the impact of Arctic oscillation in winter in Indian winter monsoon. Basically, what is the thing? This is basically the average mean precipitation, climatological mean during winter. So what is the precipitation event? During positive, the precipitation event is higher, positive AO, Arctic oscillation. And during negative oscillation, the precipitation is less. In the negative oscillation years, the precipitation is less during winter. So this is a basically study from 1979 to 2006 period it has taken. So very clearly it is demonstrated that the Arctic oscillation, whether positive or negative, it contributes to the winter rainfall. And also this is a typical picture. Of course, 2015 March rainfall, there are heavy rainfall during March, that is because of the positive phases of Arctic oscillation. Also, the another study has pointed out by Yadav et al. Basically, what they have documented is during positive phases of Arctic Arctic oscillation, and also along with the warm ENSO years, and it gives the above normal winter precipitation. Of course, the recent time it is this relation is decreased in the recent years. And also, if you see the southwest, Indian summer monsoon and Arctic oscillation, the relation between Arctic oscillation and summer monsoon, though the relations are not very good, correlation as well as R square is not good, but there are year to year variability is happening between ISMR and Arctic oscillation. And another influence of Arctic oscillation on ISMR is basically Arctic oscillation and ISMR shows direct relationship with each other in the monsoon season. And the circulation parameters in the pre-monsoon months over Arctic can be good predictors of Indian summer monsoon. Of course, this is a correlation coefficient during monsoon, how during different years, how it is changes, how the correlation, how much it is changing. And the negative Arctic oscillation from May to October allows cold Arctic air to penetrate southward. That cools Eurasia and increases the Eurasian snow cover, and hence they reduce the Indian summer monsoon rainfall. Of course, this is reported in 2017 by Cochrane and Kulkarni. So essentially what I want to convey is there are influence from Arctic oscillation to winter monsoon as well as Indian summer monsoon. There are another study by Prabhu et al. Basically, they demonstrated that interannual variation of sea ice extent and Indian summer monsoon. They have not taken total region as a whole. They have taken different region in the Arctic, especially Greenland sea ice area. They have taken and see the Indian summer monsoon correlation, and in boreal autumn and its association with the subsequent summer monsoon rainfall over India. This is what they have done. So they got some good correlation between these two, Indian summer monsoon and Greenland sea ice area. Also, there are Indian Karar and Barents Sea also, there is a correlation, but it is less than that one. There is existence of correlation. It's not only in the recent times there is a Arctic and monsoon linkages, but also in the paleoclimatic studies also show a correlation between Arctic as well as Indian summer monsoon. Specifically, the two abrupt climate changes event happened as shown documented Greenland ice core record and North Atlantic sediment have identified in the tropical past monsoon records. Basically, in the past also they have seen that the change in Arctic and correspondingly the change in monsoon pattern here. So as well as past record, as well as the recent time scale, there is a linkage between Arctic and monsoon. When you come to climate scale projection, Arctic sea ice extent, how good the Earth system model is representing the Arctic climate? Basically, in this figure, this is a IPCC report, and this is a prediction model and mean of the all the models. This is the projection, and this is observations. But if you see that observation, the Arctic sea ice is decreasing much faster than the projections. Basically, because there are many physical processes in the Arctic is not been incorporated in the climate models. Many processes in the Arctic climate system only roughly represented in most of the climate models. Hence, the Arctic prediction is having some problem. The Arctic Ocean becomes practically sea ice free in September, that means in summer months, for the first time around 2050. So in 2050, it is expected to be have no ice in summer in the Arctic. I mean, no ice means it is less than 1 million square kilometer. If 1 million square kilometer, if it is there, then any passage of it is almost less sea ice. So understanding the key climate process in the Arctic is limited by lack of observations. So that is why now more and more people started venturing to Arctic to have more observation. In that connection, the one of the important event is a mosaic program. It is basically a shipboard observation. It is basically a German vessel. It is continuously monitoring atmosphere ocean interaction in the Arctic. So far what I tried to summarize is Arctic is warming faster than rest of the planet. Sea ice and land ice is decreasing. Arctic amplification is happening, and I have shown some of its cause and connection from, because of Arctic amplification, actually it is basically the connection from tropics to poles, and Arctic oscillation I also highlighted, and basically this is the poles to tropics, and also some aspect of monsoon also changes. So essentially in shorter time scale, there is a existing atmospheric connectivity, either tropics to poles or poles to tropics. However, on the longer time scale, Arctic contributes to sea level and thermohaline circulation, which we have not studied much in detail. Hence, it is imperative to understand the physical linkages, both in terms of observation as well as modeling, between Arctic and tropics at various time scales. Hence, we need to go for Arctic research. So considering this importance, India started Indian Arctic program in the year 2017. The first batch of a five-member team led by Dr. Rasik Ravindra, Elliott director, they have started first observation in the, they started the Arctic observation in the year 2007. So they have established the Himadri station in 2008, and later on they started deploying mooring, dark mooring in 2014, and then atmospheric observatory started in 2016, and later on we started thermoforest observation in 2018. So every year we are slowly increasing our component of Arctic observation and studies. So these are the basic thrust areas of Arctic observation, what we are doing. Basically the long-term monitoring and understanding of physical, biological, chemical and biogeochemical aspect of Arctic fjords, bacterial community, dynamics in the Arctic system, and also studies on aerosol, black carbon, pollutions, glacier mass balance studies, and also ambient acoustic noise program, and monitoring degradation of permafrost. So far about 200 Indian researchers has gone to Himadri station till date, and they go for a different discipline. These are the various discipline, those who have participated from India. Of course, they will be there during summer time, most of the summer time. Almost 180 days per year, they will be in Arctic Himadri station. More than 100 publications come so far in the Arctic. So this is a Himadri station. Basically, it is a Svalbard region in Svalbard Island. So in this region, there is a Neolithic. So this Neolithic, earlier it was a coal mining industry, and that has been converted into a science village. So now this island, mostly all these buildings are research stations of different countries. So this is very unique place in Svalbard to monitor and understand the Arctic changes. And this is a unique location for research facilities, and also good access year around. And also there are 11 nations are working together. They complement each other observations and other science studies. And also it is coordinated by the Neolithic Science Manager Committee. So they coordinate this Arctic monitoring and observing system so that no one duplicate the process in the entire area, so that each country contribute uniquely some particular discipline. So these are the major activities of Arctic observations, subsurface mooring, atmospheric observation, glacier measurements, and also from last year we started spatial variability of microbial dynamics. Not only we are in Neolithic region, so just we started by moving observation from ship, we have gone all the way around the Svalbard to have a microbial and other oceanographic observations. So quickly I will summarize what are the programs. So one is Arctic fjord dynamics. Basically initially when we started the Arctic program with the ship observation, we monitored the fjord, and we have seen that every year by year the temperatures goes on increasing. Then it was decided that okay, why don't we go deploy for a mooring at that location so that we can continuously monitor temperature, salinity and other parameters. Of course during summer these very parameters from various groups of Indian researchers are monitored during summer in these sections. And whereas the blue color, whatever I indicated, is the what is called, it is the instrument or the particular parameter measured from the mooring. So we are having strong presence in the Arctic fjord monitoring system. And other interesting area which we are doing is studying mass and energy balance of the two of the important glaciers. It is a Neolithic here, the glacier Western Brogren as well as Fairbairn. These two glaciers we are always monitoring. So the typical change of the Svalbard glacier, how it is mass is changing over the period. Of course, we have put some stake in that one, and also we monitor from GPS, and we have installed many AWS to monitor the energy balance and other studies. And also we have a monitoring precipitation and aerosol studies in one of the lab in Goa Bharat in New Listen. We have installed salinometer, radiometer, and microwave rain radar, and there are many samples, air samples are collected to monitor the aerosols and other pollutions, black carbon and other studies we are monitoring continuously. And the ambient noise, it is very unique observation. Basically, the ambient noise in the fjord varies, basically depends on the ice melting, ice calving, and marine mammal noise, also ship noise. So these noises can be distinguished by the acoustic ambient noise. So considering importance of that, NIOT, of course, the mooring also deployed by NIOT, then they have incorporated this one of the hydrophone in the same mooring. Then from 2015 onwards, we are continuously monitoring the ice calving effect as well as the ice melting things which we are monitoring. Basically, when we, though we are not in the, during the winter time, we don't know whether there is a calving is happening or not, but with this instrument, it is very clearly distinguished whenever the calving event happened in the glacier, so or a glacier or in ice breaking is happening in the fjord, we can very distinctly monitor from this hydrophone array. Of course, this is developed and installed and deployed by NIOT. And another important program is Arctic biology. So basically, we do microbial community as well as the microbial diversity, bacterial diversity, and also plant and ecology, and lot of bio-optical measurements have been monitored in Kongsfjorden as well as Krasfjorden using in situ as well as satellite observations. So there are many biological observations from universities and your institute, and many Indian participants are taking observation and understanding the Arctic biology. Of course, environmental aspect also people are monitoring continuously in the Arctic fjord, basically organic matter and permafrost and aerosols and other things also they are continuously monitoring. So what is our goal? Of course, we started some observation where we want to go from here. Basically, our prime objective is to improve our understanding, the telekinesis aspect, and also we would like to have a reconstruct the past climate both using ice and sediment core, and also we would like to know what are the biodiversity exists in the Arctic and how the permafrost is thawing. So these are the major things which we want to understand in the Arctic, and for that we have to augment and more effort we have to put in terms of observation and modeling for detecting climate anomalies as well as to see the past variability. And also we have to, already we started major effort in modeling, especially CIS modeling effort. And of course, this is a CIS modeling process and sensitivity studies, we have to do that so that to see the impact of tropical teleconnection and other with various time scales. Apart from that, we have to engage in Arctic Council and its working group activities so that we continue to contribute to the global Arctic observation and understanding. So this basically the Arctic main theme in the coming next to few years, the main theme is focused by the, this is a Arctic Science Ministerial Meeting 3. Of course, this is a unique ministerial meeting, and also they every time they fine tune what is the importance. So the major theme is observe, understand, respond, and strengthen. So this area everybody has to contribute. So that aspect we are also set forth our agenda in that direction. So this is what the summary I want to conclude. Basically, Arctic is warming much faster than other places. Sea ice and ice sheet are melting rapidly, and it is due to Arctic amplification. I have mentioned some of the feedback mechanisms why it is Arctic is amplification is happening, and also what is its impact in Arctic sea ice melts. It's basically in terms of resources as well as northern sea route, and climate change effect, and also the teleconnection between tropics and Arctic. Of course, we need more observation and modeling efforts for better understanding to underpin the physical linkages. And also we have to go not only in Neolithic Svalbard, but also we have to go much beyond. We have to go for pan-Arctic approach. So in concluding, I would say that India needs to be involved in Arctic affairs for economical and geopolitical reasons apart from climate change studies. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And I will just play one small movie, about 5-6 minutes, so that you can see the glimpses of Arctic observations and what are the efforts put forth by our groups.
It's a very unique community. You know, if you suddenly come to a 79 degree north, then you are among many different countries. And so it's, I would say it's an extremely well-run operation out here.
Thank you.
item.
So I've just collected a sample of the mountain sorrel. This is a location where the glacial water melts, and I'm actually working with the microorganisms associated with the rhizosphere of these flowers in the Arctic. And if they produce any monoterpenes which have a biotechnological application.
Sampling is on trawling of the water surface. So we want to know whether the water surface of these fjords are these microplastics. Yesterday we have done sediments. Today we are doing with the microplastic net. We are trawling it for 20 minutes at two knots of speed, so that we will get to know whether the microplastics are present on the surface of these Arctic fjords.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi. Very interesting talk of Indian Arctic program connecting Arctic climate and Indian monsoon. Very informative. There are overwhelming number of questions. I'm sorry to audience, could not accommodate all, but I kept key 5 questions consolidating from many and in the chat window. So kindly read and answer, sir.
Okay, so I have 5 questions. Before answering the question, I would like to thank that movie has been provided or developed by Rakesh, and also my colleagues of Arctic team, as well as entire 20 researchers, those who have contributed to the Arctic research, I thank, and also Ministry of Earth Sciences for funding all the Arctic program. So the first question is whether Geographical Information System, GIS, is helpful for Arctic research. Is NCPOR provides any GIS data for public use? What is the scope for observation from space over the Arctic region? Please comment. Of course, GIS is a tool and it is used for any research. It is not only Arctic research, but it is used for everybody, every research. And of course, we are not directly working on any GIS tool we are not using for Arctic research, but maybe definitely it will be useful and many people will be doing that. Is NCPOR provides any GIS data to the public? We don't have any GIS data from the Arctic region. And what is the scope for observation from space over the Arctic region? Yes, there are observation. Actually, there are many satellite data provides the, of course, the CIS extent is provided by the satellite. And there are many other satellites also provides a, not only extent, it is thickness, and also there are heat content or sea level variability and other things are monitored by from space. And it's definitely, it is helpful for the understanding Arctic region. The second question is, what are the repercussions of unprecedented Arctic warming on India? Of course, whenever there is a
Hello, Dr. Ravi, can you hear us?
Basically, the question was what are the repercussions of unprecedented Arctic warming on India? So that is what we are looking for. What is the repercussion will happen? That is why our study is important. What are the things which is going to be happening? So now we are looking at from the model perspective, what are the changes? Maybe the CMIP-6 and other things we are looking at. What are the changes is going to happen? But we have to be a little careful about using the model. So basically, according to me, basically the atmospheric connectivity will change, basically tropics to poles as well as poles to tropics. And also there are long-term, there is a ocean connectivity in terms of both the sea level rise as well as thermovalent circulation will change. The sea level rise, if it has happened, it is very important because the Indian Ocean is also warming. Ocean is warming, if you take it, it is Indian Ocean. But atmospheric temperature, if it is warming, it is Arctic. So any sea level rise in Indian Ocean because of thermohaline effect, it will be much more amplified in Indian Oceans. So that is maybe the long term we have to worry about that. Is the Arctic warming impacting ocean currents and deep water formation in the North Atlantic? Yes. The Arctic warming impacting, definitely the ocean currents are modulated, and some of the observation reports are already reported that it is AMOC, that is meridional circulations are reducing, and because of the reducing, the deep water formation in the North Atlantic is changes. I think some of the aspect, I think Dr. Krishnan already explained how it is slowing down the AMOC. And the fourth one is, has NCPOR conducted any study of the fish migration to the Arctic? Is there any evidence of this migration? No, we have not studied any fish migration to the Arctic, but many other countries, especially the Norwegian community, as well as Sweden, there are many publications are there. They have demonstrated the migration of fish migration in the Arctic. And the fifth question is whether India has any specific plan to exploit natural resources from Arctic Ocean in future, and whether future monitoring initiative India would be investing in the Arctic in the next year. Whether India has any specific plan to exploit natural resources? No. Time being, there is no such type of exploitation or natural resources, especially India. So we are basically observer status, so we cannot do such things. What further monitoring initiative India would be investing in Arctic in the next years? Basically, we are only concentrated in Neolithic in Svalbard region, Arctic fjord. We are monitoring atmospheric at that location. We would like to go for beyond Svalbard. Maybe next we are planning to go for Canadian Arctic. There we want to observe many things. And also, we are also contributing to the deep ocean observation. Even I forgot to mention that some of the NIOT already they have contributed their hydrophone array for the acoustic tomography monitoring mechanism, that is the CATES program. In that CATES program, India has already provided the instrument to deploy in one of the mooring so that we can get the integrated ocean temperature of Arctic. So like that, we are slowly now next, maybe we will be going for the deep ocean observation to in collaboration with the other countries. We cannot go alone, but we have to work with the other countries for strengthening the monitoring mechanisms. These are some of the questions which I have seen in the chat box.
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Ravi, thank you very much for answering the questions. They are answered very well. And thank you very much for spending your time with this MOES webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all for joining me in this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Computer team, we can go offline. Thank you.